Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I see we have quite a crowd here. Welcome all of you, probably from some school. We'll hear the cases in the order in which they appear on the day sheet. The first case, Zhen Chao Ma and Zinging Ma versus Barr, has been submitted on the brief, so we'll go to Vincent, Lee Allen Vincent, Alvin Vincent versus Brian Williams.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court. My name is Alex Spellman, appearing on behalf of Appellant Lee Vincent, and I'd ask to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal.
All right.
Thank you. Lee Vincent's trial, his co-defendant argued that my client was guilty of first-degree murder as his theory of defense. During this trial, a juror fell in love with this co-defendant. The verdict that followed was indeed that found my client guilty of first-degree murder, but this co-defendant guilty of second-degree murder. Immediately following that, within only hours of the verdict, this juror attempted to visit the co-defendant in jail, and when she was unsuccessful in doing that, that very night she couldn't sleep, so she wrote him a love letter expressing her interest and wanting to help this defendant, as well as expressing her regret that she couldn't hold him and touch him that very night. Immediately following that, they started exchanging sexually and romantically charged letters with one another, which we've quoted extensively in the briefing. I won't repeat here.
Didn't we have a hearing about this?
Yes, Your Honor. Yes, there's no. Our claim is not that they were denied the post-conviction hearing to which you're entitled in this scenario. There was indeed a hearing.
In fact, there was a hearing, and your client filed a motion for a new trial. But as I understand, the motion for new trial from your client was not about this.
That's correct, Your Honor.
It was about severance.
That's correct.
So, but the person she allegedly fell in love with, his motion for new trial was all about juror misconduct.
That's right, Your Honor.
But your client never filed such a motion.
That's exactly right, Your Honor.
So how do you get here?
We get here because the state court considered the claim on post-conviction. When our office took the case, we were able to file a post-conviction petition and have a new hearing that the state court decided to entertain and held a second hearing on the matter this time.
So at this time, we've had two hearings in the trial court about what happened here, right?
That's correct, Your Honor.
And in the first hearing that the trial court held, they found no problem.
They found, for the co-defendant, that they found that there was no misconduct as related to the co-defendant.
And in the second hearing, they found no problem?
I would dispute that characterization. The court did find in the second hearing that the feelings this juror had arose during trial.
I understand that, but they found no prejudice.
That's correct. The court drew the conclusion that this failed to recognize under our argument why this bias that actually did exist in favor of the co-defendant disadvantaged my client.
So this particular judge had in front of him all of the parties and listened to all the evidence, and after getting through doing all of that, then it found no prejudice.
That's correct, Your Honor.
Now, I guess I'm trying to figure out what degree of deference do I owe to that finding?
Right, Your Honor. So, of course,
right? The question is very simple.
Yes.
What degree of deference do I owe to that trial court's finding?
28 U.S.C. 2254E1 states that there's a presumption of correctness to factual findings, but that factual finding presumption is rebuttable by clear and convincing evidence. So that's our starting point.
So therefore, at this point, what the trial court decided was fine, unless there's clear and convincing evidence to the opposition.
I have a few points about that. First is, of course, that our primary argument is that we do meet that standard.
Well, I understand, but I'm just trying to make sure, because frankly, I was a trial judge once. I held hearings all the time. When I did that, I listened to the evidence. I heard it. I went through all the situation. And as long as I applied the rules right, the appellate court, which in my case was the Idaho Supreme Court, but it could have been this court because they always got it on habeas anyway, they had to give me some deference as to what I was doing. And I guess the worry that I have is that you're asking me to say, that trial judge, now we've had two good trial judges who've heard all this once and decided whether it made any difference first to Vasquez and now to your client, said it didn't. And now you're saying I should just forget that and join you and throw it out.
I wouldn't ask you to forget what the district court did at all. The first point is that it was actually the same judge who heard this hearing twice.
I understand it was the same.
And so one of our points that I'd like to address is that the judge actually made inconsistent findings between the first hearing and the second. And to explain, when the judge first heard the matter on a motion for rehearing, she heard all the evidence, and then when it came around to the sentencing hearing for the co-defendant, the judge actually agreed with the state's argument that this juror did violate her oath and did bring this bias into deliberations. The court and the prosecution seemed to be in agreement that the only way to explain the second degree murder conviction for the co-defendant was that the juror actually was biased. And so,
isn't your best argument that this was implied bias versus actual bias?
Yes, Your Honor, that is my entirely separate point. Is under an implied bias theory, regardless of what the juror says, whether they were able to put this bias aside or not, our argument is that categorically, the type of bias this juror had presumes her bias as a matter of law. And as Justice O'Connor described in Smith v. Phillips in her concurrence, that would overcome the presumption of correctness because it is a legal presumption.
And where in your brief to me did you argue implied bias?
Right, Your Honor, I'm sorry, I don't have the citation right
now. Well, I don't think you have the citation because I don't think you argued it.
Well, we have, I apologize. We have argued implied bias throughout the history of this litigation.
Just a minute. I looked very carefully to make sure. There's no question you argued some implied bias in the state court, and you may even have said something to the district court. But when I read your briefs, I couldn't find it.
Right, Your Honor. I apologize for not having the citation on hand for that particular point.
Well, if you waived it by not arguing it, I don't have to, as quoting Zanino, I don't have to do your work, create the ossature for the argument and put flesh on its bones.
Right. So this is why I might not have used the phrase implied bias in my brief.
You think that would have been helpful?
Yes, absolutely.
And what
yes.
cases did you cite that were applied bias?
Dyer v. Cauldron is cited in my brief.
I believe that was that in your reply brief that you...
It was in the opening brief and the reply brief that I put it in there. And my reply brief extensively discusses, based on the arguments the state made in this case, how the substance of the implied bias claim that I'm making now. And so the point of both of my briefs was that this was the type of bias at the moment the juror walked into the deliberations with, no matter what she said about, oh, I could put it aside, as a matter of law, you can't. That's been my consistent argument throughout the appeal, even if I didn't use the word implied.
I didn't put the argument dead in front of you, Judge, I want you to now think about it and put some bones to it. Is that what you're saying?
I'd ask this court just to interpret my argument. I do believe it's consistent for throughout this case, but again, that's just one theory of why we win. I think that no matter what test you apply, Vincent, nonetheless, the bottom line is that he had a biased juror in deliberations. We know that the state court found that these feelings arose.
Oh, just a minute, let's look at that again. In the hearing, we found there was no contact with Vasquez before the verdict.
Correct.
The research was only after the verdict?
That's correct.
They did not discuss outside information with the other jurors?
That's correct, Your Honor.
And therefore, there is no contact at all between this juror and Vasquez prior to verdict.
Right. That would be under
and no discussion with other jurors of her feelings or any part of it.
Well, that we don't have to prove whether or not she actually discussed her feelings with other jurors.
I understand that. I'm just trying to get the facts.
That's the facts. That never came out.
And so therefore, what you're suggesting is, and in fact, the district court found, or the PCR court found, no real problem with the whole of the procedure. The feelings did not come into play at all. That's what the juror said. I voted the way I'm going to vote, regardless of that. Isn't that true?
The court did find that, but
the only reason I'm trying to get the facts down here is that I want you to step back. Every juror goes into a trial, don't they? With no knowledge, but when they get there, they find things that happen during the trial. Sometimes they like people and sometimes they don't. This particular juror, for some reason or another, went farther than that. But there could be a juror who hated the person. And all I'm saying to you is it seems to me that you're now suggesting we go through all kinds of procedure to make sure we don't have all of this bias going in. But once getting there, what the jurors think or do or might think about people, we have never gotten into that. And so I'm trying to figure out why it is that on this particular occasion we should do that, and what is the consequence for the future? Why is this different than any other case?
If I may respond, I am out of time.
Well, you may respond.
Thank you, Your Honor. This is, of course, a very unusual case, I would say, in that
Why is it unusual?
I don't think that I wasn't able to find a single case in all
just
my research.
Because you weren't able to find. But, I mean, there could be many cases where people hate them after they get there, and it just doesn't come up. Or other cases where they think, oh, this is a really cute juror, a really cute defendant, but it doesn't come up. But from now on, if I make this decision, I'm going to give people like you the opportunity, not that you're not a good lawyer, and I want good lawyers, but every time we'll have this.
I just think that the romance is different, and the degree of
why
the
is
feelings.
Romance different than hate?
Well, hate is also a form of bias. If we could prove that the juror hated someone and they were making decisions not based on their oath.
Then every jury that we're going to have from now on, we're going to have attorneys out there trying to figure out if they loved them or if they hated them, because then we'll have this kind of a hearing?
Well, Your Honor, if they hate them based on the evidence that they heard, that would be one thing. But if they have romantic feelings just based on a biological attraction, that's something categorically different. That has nothing to do with the presentation of the evidence, the conduct of the defendant.
Well, but the presentation of the evidence, what happened in this particular trial, the judge said it all happened fine. Nothing. This did not have any effect on it whatsoever. Judge found, right?
That is what the judge found. I believe that we've rebutted that presumption by clear and convincing evidence. And here the evidence is overwhelming that the juror actually brought this bias to bear, and it actually played a role in deliberations. And we believe, based on the plain language of the Sixth Amendment, that the presence of this single biased juror violated my client's constitutional rights.
The last thing you said caught my attention. Where is the evidence that the juror said that her romance for Vasquez caused her to vote one way for Vasquez and another way against your client?
The juror denied that it did. And the evidence...
But you said there was evidence that it affected the verdict. My question is, where's the evidence?
The juror expressly admitted to the Las Vegas Review-Journal that she was a holdout juror for Vasquez. Then all her conduct thereafter shows that this was something she believed she was doing something wrong. She wrote to the co-defendant in a false name. She was clearly willing to get in trouble, to risk getting in trouble for this. The state's argument at sentencing is consistent with what I'm saying now, that this was the state's position, and why it even originally came up was that this juror had violated her oath in bringing this to bear during deliberations. The court agreed with that and actually sentenced the co-defendant to the maximum sentence under second-degree murder under the presumption that he should have been convicted under first-degree murder. So only because I'm so out of time, but I would love to go into it more. But the record is replete with evidence why this juror, it just clearly rebuts any presumption that it seems like a perfunctory finding after the second hearing that, and contradictory with what was clearly on the record originally, that this juror actually did bring this information, bring these feelings, and advocated for this co-defendant. And the best way to do that would have been to advocate for the co-defendant in the exact same way that the co-defendant's attorney was asking the jury to do. It was him, not my guy. And so if that's not fair to have a juror who has those feelings and that preference on the jury advocating for a guy.
We've taken you past your time. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Your Honor.
Good morning. May it please the court. My name is Ashley Balducci, and I represent the appellees. In the time I've been given, I'd like to discuss 3 points. My first point, regardless of whether the court applies epideference or de novo review, petitioner's juror misconduct and bias claim fails. The court should apply epideference because the Nevada Supreme Court adjudicated the claim on the merits. Under Johnson v. Williams, when a state court rejects a federal claim that's been presented to it without expressly addressing the claim, a federal court is to presume that the federal claim was adjudicated on the merits.
I think that your opponent assumes that. He's saying that under 2254E1, the presumption of correctness as to the fact of bias is overcome by implied bias. You disagree with that?
Well, I mean, that applies regardless. E1 applies to de novo review as well. And he's trying to say, well, the state court was inconsistent. He's rebutted that he's shown by clear and convincing that it's not entitled to a presumption of correctness because he says the state court, or petitioner says, excuse me, that the state court in 2008 and in 2012 was inconsistent in its findings. But that's untrue because in 2008, only juror misconduct had been raised by the co-defendant, and bias had actually not been delved into until 2012 at the evidentiary hearing when the petitioner raised the juror bias claim.
But what did the Supreme Court respond when they had it the second time?
The second time, if you look at the order of affirmance, footnote 1, the state court said petitioner abandoned this claim, which would have precluded consideration by the Nevada Supreme Court. The Nevada Supreme Court rejected the state's argument and said no, and in fact, it's appropriate for us to consider this claim. And before, so.
And then what did they say?
And then they applied the doctrine of the law of the case.
But the law of the case did not even approach this particular issue, because it wasn't in that case before that.
And again, under Early versus Packer, Your Honor, the Supreme Court has stated that just because the state court doesn't apply Supreme Court precedent or even aware of it, that doesn't mean.
But that's not the issue, or that's not the argument. The argument is, if they'd have simply affirmed, we would take what you had to say and we would say no question. But they didn't. They said law of the case, meaning the same reasons we gave the first time, we're giving the second time, even though that issue isn't even in it the second time.
But footnote 1 indicates that the Nevada Supreme Court at least considered the claim before it applied the doctrine of the law of the case. Nevertheless, the court doesn't need to decide this issue because under EPA or de novo review, petitioner's juror misconduct and bias claim fails. The Supreme Court has held that when there's the remedy for an allegation of juror partiality is a hearing in which the defendant has an opportunity to prove actual bias. That happened in this case. The state district court ordered an evidentiary hearing. The state district court, after hearing the testimony of Juror Ramirez, found that Juror Ramirez had not done anything wrong either during trial or during the deliberative process. Now again, those findings of facts are entitled to a presumption of correctness. This case also doesn't present the kind of case of implied bias because...
Well, I guess that's the question, because it seems to me the district court and the PCR court said what they had to say about these particular matters, but with implied bias, it seems to me in those particular matters, they don't have to really show any prejudice, do they? It's just kind of implied in the fact that it exists.
That's correct, Your Honor, but...
And if it implied in the fact that it exists, then at that point, how do I get around it?
Well, implied bias, I mean, to the extent that the court plays epideference, implied bias is not clearly established.
Well, I'm not supposing I don't do epideference.
All right, so under de novo review, it still doesn't meet the standard because in order to show implied bias, there has to be a relationship between the prospective juror, again, indicating that this relationship has to somewhat pre-exist at voir dire. And then...
Why is that? Why wouldn't it be the equivalent? I mean, the reason why we don't want the relationship is because of the bias that is implied by the person having these feelings toward the juror having these feelings towards the defendant. So why wouldn't this equate that type of a relationship?
Because at the time she was found to have be able to put away her impressions and opinions and decide the case based off the evidence presented. And
I think you're going, that would be the prejudice or the actual bias theory. But why wouldn't it be under the implied bias theory that this relationship would equate the relationship suggested in or part of the test that was suggested by Justice O'Connor in her concurrence in the case?
Oh, in Smith v. Phillips?
Yes.
Is that what you're referring to? Well, again, in Smith v. Phillips, O'Connor pointed to specific cases in which they found implied bias. But again, this situation doesn't actually meet any of those certain situations. And again, as Justice Smith has pointed out, I mean, how is this any different when a juror doesn't like a particular attorney or doesn't care for the co-defendant? And so in every case we would have this if in fact it was extended to this certain type of situation. This is just not the extreme circumstances that were presented in other cases, such as cases where the juror was dishonest during voir dire and it was on a material fact that had the juror answered correctly, it would have been a basis for a cause. Here, the state district court found Juror Ramirez had not, even if she had developed feelings during the trial for the co-defendant, that she did nothing wrong during the trial or the deliberated process. And again, if you look at that Las Vegas Review Journal that petitioner pointed to during his argument, in that statement where she says, I was a holdout juror for voluntary manslaughter, right after that, she says, based off the evidence presented. So again, there's just simply not the type of situation that has been seen before in Ninth Circuit precedent or Supreme Court precedent to extend implied bias to this situation. There's no extraordinary circumstances.
It seems to me that it's a hard case for you to make after what the state argued at the sentencing of Vasquez.
But I believe the U.S. District Court also discussed this as well and footnoted that arguments by attorney are not evidence. And at that point, the state hadn't actually been presented with a juror bias claim.
But they're not arguments in front of the jury. They're arguments to the court on a sentence. And you're making these arguments as if they're something that's where you're going to go. And that's what you now believe. And yet, if I look at those arguments and then I try to see the arguments you're making here, those arguments would suggest that's absolutely extraordinary and extreme. So, judge, give him the harshest sentence you could possibly give him. But then when you come here, you're saying, Oh, this isn't extreme or extraordinary at all.
Well, again, Your Honor, the state made that before there was any juror bias delved into that was made at sentencing, and petitioner had not raised a claim of juror bias at that point. It was in 2012 when we heard the testimony of Juror Ramirez, and it was ultimately found that she didn't commit any juror misconduct or had any bias, either in favor for the co-defendant or against the petitioner. I'm running out of time, so my last point would be that petitioner's ineffective assistance of counsel claim fails. I'm sorry, I'm running out of time. but my last point I'd like to make is that on petitioner's ineffective assistance of counsel claim, he's failed to demonstrate prejudice.
We'll give you a couple of minutes more because we took him over. Okay,
thank you, Your Honor. I'm sorry. I'm trying to make sure I get everything in here that I wanted to get. Based off of his, the claim's kind of somewhat unclear as to what trial counsel failed to do, but to the extent that he's arguing that trial counsel should have questioned Juror Ramirez at the 2008 evidentiary hearing or further investigated the juror bias at that point, again, the petitioner has failed to demonstrate prejudice that, but for a reasonable probability, but for trial counsel's error, that the result of the proceedings would have been different. There was overwhelming evidence of guilt presented at trial and just to name a few, it was the eyewitness testimony of Farron Estrada, who testified that her and the petitioner set up the drug deal between the victim and the petitioner. It was the petitioner who asked her about robbing the victim. There was no evidence adduced that the co-defendant was aware of the robbery, and that's reflective in the actual conviction of first-degree murder and second-degree murder. And again, appellees would respectfully request that this court affirm the district court's denial and uphold the petitioner's conviction for first-degree murder. And unless you have any other questions, I will submit.
I have one.
Okay.
Did counsel waive this implied bias claim in his briefing here? I didn't see it in anything in your brief. I'm the only one arguing it, I guess.
No, I would argue
it. I only question about it.
No, but I would argue he has. I know he did serve a 28J letter regarding the implied bias, and he did cite to authorities.
You didn't brief it, did you?
No, he did not.
All right.
All right. Thank you very much. The case
Thank
is submitted.
You.
We've taken you over your time. So the case of Vincent versus Williams is now submitted.